We don't have to do everything, but we have to do our part. Be a good influence wherever your sphere of influence may be. So often we think our jobs are to be useful to God, when in fact our real jobs are to glorify God in all that we do. We do that in part with our work, but not only through our work. Our job is to make disciples for the transformation of the world, and that is a group project. No one person can do that alone. My husband and I were traveling for his birthday a few weeks ago, and we had a very interesting breakfast. It was perhaps the loveliest breakfast I have ever had. We didn't realize it when we walked in to the room, but by quirk of a significant reservation system error, my husband and I were seated at breakfast with a table of highly, highly successful health and wellness Instagram influencers. We did not know it. We were having breakfast and we were chatting with this lovely woman across the table from us, and we did notice that a great deal of attention was being paid to what this young woman had for breakfast. There were a lot of photos. There were extravagant flower arrangements. The food came out more beautifully arranged than I have ever seen a platter of fruit arrive at a table. There were lots of photos. There were conversations. The staff was incredibly attentive to her every bite. The head chef from the dinner restaurant at the resort came out to chat with her about her pancakes. There was a great, long, detailed discussion about honey. Is honey vegan? Is it not vegan? This is apparently an issue of great debate among vegan communities. I was watching, but I couldn't help wondering, how many people really care about what this young woman is having for breakfast? I looked it up later. You know how many people were watching this young woman have breakfast? 946,000 people cared what this young woman had for breakfast. Whether or not she ate honey was going to influence whether or not her followers ate honey. People actually really cared what she ate. And it began a discussion between my husband and I, in part because we realized she was probably being comped and we were paying for breakfast. And we began to debate, you know, we're influencers. I preach. That's a little bit of an influence. My husband, you know, he speaks at conferences about employment law. Does that count as an influencer? You know, how many followers do you need to have before you can get your breakfast comped as an influencer? And it turned into a funny discussion, but it actually has made me think in the weeks following about what it means to be an influencer in today's world. Webster's Dictionary actually has recently updated their definition of what it means to be an influencer. It traditionally has just said one who exerts influence over someone else, what you would expect, but they have now added a clause, and it says specifically and often, a person who is able to generate interest in something such as a consumer product by posting about it on social media. And when we use the term influencer today, that's often what we think about, isn't it? And it makes me wonder, you know, has anyone here ever been influenced by something they've seen on social media? I will admit that I have been. I have the kitchen gadgets to prove it yet, right? What have you been influenced by? Are you willing to share?
Probably Fortnite.
Fortnite. There we go, right? At any age, from Fortnite to kitchen whisks, we are influenced by what we see on our social media feeds. And, you know, that isn't necessarily a bad thing. My conversation with the young wellness influencer really convinced me I needed to increase my fruit intake. It helped me think about my yoga practice as a form of contemplative prayer and how important that is. We can learn things from influencers. Our church social media accounts that Kimberly curates so well, you know, they can teach people something about Jesus that they might not otherwise see. And increasingly, they're the front door for the church for so many of our new visitors. If that's you, if you're watching online, welcome. You know, whether you come through our doors physically or you come through our social media doors, everyone is welcome here, and we're thrilled to extend that welcome. But I can't help but wonder, what does it mean not just to be an influencer, but a good influencer? Because there are certainly bad influences out there as well. We all know that. And I think to look at that, it's important to look to Scripture for an answer to what it means to be a good influencer. And I like the way Paul explained it to the church in Ephesus. I think that his definition stands the test of time very well. He says, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. I think that's a great definition of what it means to be a good influence. And I think all of us, perhaps moms especially, really worry about what it means to be a good influence on the children in our lives. But it's something that's really important at any age. You know, Dr. Kerr was going to be here this weekend. He was yesterday at CMU. He was giving the commencement address at CMU. And I have no doubt that his speech was a good influence on those young people. I love commencement speeches. Some of you have heard me do whole sermons that are based on commencement speeches, because I think that they're a real attempt to influence young lives. And what does it mean to be a good influence? I think sometimes it is an institution's last big attempt to exert influence on their graduates before they walk across that stage and out into the world. And I really love it when commencement speeches are turned into books that you can read. They make such nice, short summer beach reads, right? Like just the right amount of inspiration. My book group in June is actually going to be reading one. It's Anna Quinlan's book, A Short Guide to a Happy Life. If you've never been a part of my book group, I'd love to have you. We meet on Zoom once a month. And this month we're talking about Anna Quinlan's graduation speech in book format. And in that book, she says this. She says, get a life, a real life, not a manic pursuit of the next promotion, the next paycheck, the larger house. Do you think you'd care so very much about these things if you blew an aneurysm one afternoon or found a lump in your breast? Get a life in which you notice the smell of salt water pushing itself on a breeze over seaside heights. A life in which you stop and watch how a red-tailed hawk circles over the water gap, or the way a baby scowls with concentration when she tries to pick up a Cheerio with her thumb and her first finger. I have to tell you, my grandchild is incredibly advanced and can do this already. I almost had Kimberly use a video of my grandchild picking up Cheerios as the walk-up video, but I spared you. She says, turn off your cell phone. Turn off your regular phone, for that matter. She's dating herself there. How many of us don't even have a regular phone anymore, right? Yeah, we don't either. She says, keep still, be present. Get a life in which you are not alone. Find people you love and people who love you. And remember that love is not leisure, it is work. Each time you look at your diploma, remember that you are still a student, still learning how to best treasure your connection to others. Pick up the phone, send an email, write a letter, kiss your mom, hug your dad. Get a life in which you are generous. Look around at the azaleas in the stubborn neighborhood where you grew up. Look at a full moon hanging in the black, black sky on a cold night. Anybody see the northern lights this weekend? Weren't they amazing? Yeah. Look, if you looked up this weekend, you got a real treat. And she says this. She says, realize that life is the best thing ever and that you have no business taking it for granted. Care so deeply about its goodness that you want to spread it around. Once in a while, take money that you would have spent on beers and give it to charity. Work in a soup kitchen, be a big brother or a big sister. All of you want to do well, but if you do not do good too, then doing well will never be enough. I like that. There's a difference between doing good and doing well. And there are countless examples of these sorts of speeches, but I think that the essential part of being an influencer, the essential part of a life well led, is recognizing that what we do with our lives really matters. We have choices, and our choices matter. They make a difference. They can change the world. And that may seem hard to believe when the problems of the world seem overwhelming. You know, if you open your phone on any given morning to whatever news app you prefer, there are enough problems to occupy your mind for the whole day, are there not? I was really saddened by an op-ed piece in the New York Times this spring a few weeks ago that argued one of the reasons we're seeing increased depression in young adults is because young people have lost their faith, religious faith, as an anchor in their lives. And the author argued that earlier generations of young activists that were working for changes in the world were anchored by certain important things that gave them a fundamental optimism even as they fought injustice. And chief among them was Christianity, the social gospel of American Christianity that's anchored so many reforms, From the New Deal reforms, my book group read about Eleanor Roosevelt and Mary Bethune and how they were anchored by faith when they fought for reformations in that period of time. You can think of Martin Luther King and the way he had faith in that long arc of justice, that even if he didn't see it himself, he believed that the arc of justice was long, but it bent in the right direction, that God was a part of the plan. And this author argued that many young people today lack that anchor in faith. They lack a belief in God and a trust in that long arc of divine justice that Martin Luther King had faith in. And that without it, a young person's desire to do good in the world can lead not to hope, but to despair, because it feels overwhelming. If you look at the problems of the world and you think that it is up to you alone to solve them, it can be overwhelming. I saw that outlook in another commencement book that's out there. It's called Assume the Worst, the commencement speech you will never hear. And it's meant to be a cynical riff on graduation speeches. The author argues that if you assume the worst, you won't be caught off guard. Not an optimistic message. He says you can't assume the world is going to get better, though. And this I agree with. He says you have to choose to make it so. And despite all of his cynicism about assuming the worst, he reached a conclusion that I do agree with. He said, if I were speaking to actual graduates, I could look out over the crowd and predict with absolute certainty that some of you are blessed with monster talent and you will do amazing things. You won't change the whole world, but you will change somebody's world, and you'll change it for the better. But just as inevitably, some of you won't. And while this is clearly a book of adult satire with a lot of adult language, I don't recommend it to a family reading group. His point resonated with me. Some of us will use our influence to change our little corner of the world for better. Some of us will use our influence for the better. We will spread goodness, as Anna Quinlan advises. Some of us will feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the sick. And some of us won't. Some of us will be the voice of the voiceless, as Jesus calls us to be. We will take that example and live into it. And some of us won't. But why? I think faith has a lot to do with it. When our desire to do good is anchored in faith, I think we don't overwhelm so easily. And I think we're actually empowered to do better work and to sustain that work over a longer period of time. How many people here, I know it's a lot, have been working to feed hungry people in this community for, you know, more than 10 years? Like, I know you're out there. You know, more than 20. We've done it a long time. And yet when we go Monday night to feed the hungry, there will be hungry people there again, right? And yet, our faith anchors us so that we don't see that as overwhelming. We see it as an opportunity to do good. Of divine within us. What helps us to go out into the world and use that spark to do good transformational work? I think we have to ask ourselves, who and what do we allow to have influence over us? Where do we place our faith? There are countless Bible stories that point toward the answer. If we open the prayer book of the Bible, the book of Psalms, we read that King David, the author of most of those Psalms, struggled with the very same issues all those years ago. He had a lot of issues that could have overwhelmed him. By the time he reached old age, he had been forced to defend his country, his kingdom, his life so many times that he could have easily given up hope. He had succeeded at many things, and he had failed at many things. His marital failures were epic. There were dreams that he had realized and dreams that he had that had been absolutely shattered. But he held on to his faith as God, and his words still speak beautifully to us about how to react to an uncertain world. I invite you to listen to the first half of Psalm 37, which David wrote late in his life, maybe a commencement speech of sorts to those who would follow him, and hear how it speaks to us still today. David said, trust in the Lord and do good. Live in the land and farm faithfulness. Enjoy the Lord and he will give you what your heart asks. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him. He will act and he will make your righteousness shine like the dawn, your justice like high noon. Be still before the Lord and wait for him. Don't get upset when someone gets ahead, someone who invents evil schemes. Let go of anger and leave rage behind. Don't get upset. It will only lead to evil. I think we should all just set our phones so that that psalm comes up after we read the news every morning. You know, don't go to rage, but ask yourself instead, how can I put my faith in God and therefore do good? You know, David was an influencer in his own troubled world, but he had faith that while he was an influencer, he was not the only influence. He put his faith in God. When the world seems overwhelming, David said, trust in the Lord. Before you attempt to change the world, put your faith in God. Start by trusting God. That's not the sort of trust that sits on its hands hoping God is going to take care of everything. David was never one to sit on his hands and do nothing. Hear the whole phrase. David says, trust in the Lord and do good. Trust in the Lord is an active sort of trust, but the activity is anchored in faith. So often in Scripture, trust is called out as the flip side of fear. Whereas fear can paralyze us, trust and faith empower us. David says this over and over in the Psalms. Whenever I am afraid, I put my trust in you, David says. The Bible commands us in book after book, verse after verse, 140 times in the Bible, we are told not to be afraid. It is the commandment Jesus commands most often. Do not be afraid. Trust in the Lord and therefore do good. Trust comes first and then comes the good work. Don't be overwhelmed, Scripture is telling us. Don't despair thinking that it's all up to you and you're not enough. Trust in the Lord and therefore do good. Farm faithfulness. Commit your way. Hope in the Lord. Work for peace. Be generous. Be kind. Be welcoming. Trust that God will use those actions to change the world. We don't have to do everything, but we have to do our part. Be a good influence wherever your sphere of influence may be. As Pastor Terry tells the pastoral team whenever we start to get overwhelmed, she says, if you are so afraid of failing that you do nothing, you've already failed. And that's so important. That attitude allows us to try new things. And some of them work and some of them don't. But that's okay. Because when you trust in the Lord, you are empowered to try. And know that you're going to fail sometimes. That the small thing you do may not do everything. That you may not change the world alone. But your efforts matter. You know, my uncle was a huge influencer in my life. He was a pastor. He died not all that long ago. We don't typically wear stoles in this service, but when we wear stoles at the 11, those beautiful old stoles I wear, those were all my uncle's. He actually gave them to me before he passed away, which was a lovely gift. And in the year or so since his death, I sometimes pull out the file of sermons. He had kept all of his sermons since the 60s, so neatly typed up and in a file. And my cousins gave it to me after his funeral last year. And in one of my favorites, it was his very first sermon that he preached when he was appointed in the Texas Conference. And he said this. He said, the issue is not what great things we can do. The issue is, can we do small things in a great way through our Lord Jesus Christ? God calls us not to do great things, but he calls us to do things in his service. He will make them great. He will take our efforts and use them and make them great in his service. And when we allow him to use us and allow him to work through us, miracles will take place and wonderful things will happen. For God takes those things in our life and uses them for fulfilling his will, not only for us, but for those around us, for our church and our community. It is to this that God calls us. And I think it was that attitude that anchored him as a young, optimistic pastor in the turbulent 60s and the work that he did then. An optimism that's shared by Mother Teresa as well. Mother Teresa, who did a few influential commits and speeches herself, gave this advice as her words to live by. She said, "Small things done with great love will change the world." Small things done with great love will change the world. She believed that to hand someone a piece of bread was a transformational act. Like my uncle, she taught that small things done with great love can change everything. A simple meal, a piece of bread, fried fish served around a table in community on a Sunday afternoon. The way that we work together to raise up children in faith in the church, that they'll grow up with faith and not live in despair. All of these children, whether we are their biological or their foster or their step or their adoptive moms, they're all our children. I'm wearing a bracelet that one of Nick's girls gave me, and I cherish it because it's a reminder to me that all of these kiddos, we share them together. When we raise them up to have faith and optimism, those little acts, those small acts, they're going to build up and change a generation. Someone plants and someone waters, and we work together, and God makes our efforts grow. But this isn't just a call to work with confidence. I was reminded in my book group this week that so often we think our jobs are to be useful to God, when in fact our real jobs are to glorify God in all that we do. We do that in part with our work, but not only through our work. The call to do good, to work with confidence, also needs to be a call to stop working with confidence on occasion. I think this might be an important Mother's Day lesson for some of us. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy, God says. Be still and know that I am God. Remember the story of Mary and Martha? It is the woman who decided to sit at Jesus' feet and not make lunch that Jesus said chose the better path. Do your work with faith, Scripture tells us, but also know that the work is not up to you alone, and therefore you are allowed to rest. You know, at our core, Methodists believe in the balance between that social holiness and a personal holiness. We have to have both in order to do good work. Here's a pop quiz. I know our confirmation students could answer it. When we talk about social holiness, what do we mean? What's an act of social holiness? Come on. What's social holiness when we take the things we believe out into the world and do good work? It's an example of that good work. How about Haven Street or doing vacation Bible school at a church that isn't our own? Sending money to Costa Rica so that kids can have fresh vegetables there. All acts of social holiness. But they need to be balanced, our tradition tells us, with acts of personal holiness too. What do you think those might look like? There are practices of prayer. When we gather in small groups and we nurture one another, when we read scripture, when we walk the labyrinth out back, it's a balance. Personal holiness practices, they give us strength. They fill our well so that we can go out and do good work. Because the reality is that most things aren't going to be done by one person alone. They're going to be done by communities. Things get done when we work together. Our job is to make disciples for the transformation of the world. And that is a group project. No one person can do that alone. The world is transformed one loving action at a time. A seed planted, a child fed, a kind word spoken. And every time we commit to doing good work, with faith in God's love for every single one of his children, we begin the work of transforming the world. I'm going to go ahead and call the band back up. It reminds me of what Pastor Tim said last week, that our faith is both vertical between us and God and between each other. You know, social holiness, personal holiness, they all matter. I'm going to give you one more story about a small act that can transform the world. I am not an expert on Catholic saints, but there is another St. Teresa that I admire, and I want to send you out with her story. St. Teresa of the Little Flower. Not Mother Teresa. This Teresa was born in 1886. Her own mother died when she was only 14 years old. She was actually only four when her mother died. Her older sisters were all in the convent, and so she was given a special dispensation to enter the convent young, since her only family was there at the convent. And she desperately wanted to be a missionary, but she had incredibly poor health. She suffered from tuberculosis, and she died at the age of 24. She had often referred to herself as the tiniest of God's flowers. And she sometimes struggled because she had a desire to do something big and important. She had a desire to be an influencer, but she was young and in poor health, and she lived out her entire life quietly in that convent under her sister's care. But when she passed away, her sister found a little book that she had written. It was essentially a diary that she had written for her older sister, who was the mother of the convent at that time. And it wasn't written to be a famous speech. She didn't know it was going to go straight to book form. She never thought anyone but her sister would read it. But her words were full of love, and they were full of wisdom and grace, and her sister actually sent it around to other convents as a death announcement. And the other convents, the women in those convents, read it and were so touched by her words that they shared it. And in an age where it was technologically impossible for something to go viral, Teresa's little book went viral. She was an influencer before there were influencers. And her life, her very quiet life, a life that consisted entirely of personal practices of prayer and contemplation and writing, she's changed the world. She's influenced so many people with this way known as the little way, the notion that small things done with great love can change the world. Those famous words of Mother Teresa that we all know, Mother Teresa was influenced by little Teresa. And then my uncle was influenced by her, and I was influenced by him, and so it goes. And so I ask you, who will you influence? We aren't all going to be famous influencers. No one is ever going to care what most of us had for breakfast. We may not get our breakfast comped at the Ritz, but I will tell you, we have influence. The things we do matter. The small things are the big things. So as we pray, I invite you to reflect on the small things you might be doing in your own life to share God's love with all of his children throughout the world. Will you pray with me? Good and gracious God, help us to remember that the small things are not small things, that the seemingly small acts of love and grace and generosity of care, especially those acts for the children that you place in our care as a church, that they're not small things, they're huge things in a life of faith. Help us to have hope. Help our hope, our faith, our love to anchor us to do good work in the world and to never despair, knowing that we are co-laborers with you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.